freezes and concerns. Please be sure to sign the pads that are along the center aisle and pass those down the pew. We invite everyone who is with us to take a moment at some point today to read through the announcements that are in the bulletin as a way of being connected in our community of faith. Our graduates, we will recognize on June 2nd, that first Sunday of June. We ask that you please make sure that we are aware of students who are graduating from high school, technical school, or college, and to let us know that please by May 15th. June 2nd is also the day that we will be announcing the recipients of the annual scholarship awards. Summer music time is approaching. The services June 2nd through September 1st will provide special music while the choir is off for the summer season. And if you would like to provide special music, please let Becky Davis know and she will be delighted to add you to the schedule. We are working to relaunch the 11:15 service and our first meeting is this evening at 6:30 in the parlor. Vacation Bible School is having its first of several workmates on Wednesday, May 8th from 5 to 7 in the Student Ministry Center. That you will join us as we begin preparing for VBS, which is in July. On Pentecost, June 9th, we invite you to wear red clothing to celebrate the day that the Spirit descends like flames. Today is Native American Ministry Sunday. There is a yellow insert in the bulletin. We ask you to pray about giving to support Native American congregations in the United Methodist Church and to equip seminary students who are Native American. We do not presently have anyone in the hospital, of which I am aware. Brian Wasco had a back injection this week and is continuing to recover from that. Jeanette Ferguson is home and continuing to recover from her stay in the hospital. Don Gibbs is out of rehab and is also here. Yay! I looked in the wrong spot. I had your assigned seat memorized as being a few paces back there, Don. Sorry. And it is good to see you back among us. And I understand that you were here last week, but I wasn't, so. Okay, and if there are any other prayers or praises that you would like to have included, we will, I see James has his hand lifted. I know it's a family breakfast announcement, so it's a communion Sunday, but I'm going to make an exception because I want to make sure to give James that opportunity. Please do.
Good morning. On behalf of the Methodist men, I'd like to thank everybody that helped out yesterday. We served 263, which was pretty good. And also, I have on sale in the refrigerator two boxes of cooked sausages. They're already pre-cooked. All you do is take them home, pop them in the oven, and you're good to go. And it tastes excellent. So if you'd like to hear a person, just see me after the service. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Last year we had people ask if there was a place they could purchase that sausage. Sadly, it's not a store available item. It comes from special ordering that James does. All right. If you have any prayer requests, please be sure to fill out a prayer card. At this time, we will have our Ministries That Matter. Jim Thistlewood is going to share a word with us on Pray One, Stay One.
Good morning. I'm Jim Thistlewood, the assistant lay leader at church, and I'd like to address a new program that we're having. I first want to thank everybody that participated in the financial portion of the stewardship campaign as it winds down. Notice I say winds down, it's not over. If for some reason you weren't able or haven't been here, we still are in that campaign. But we're in the second phase now, and that's the part where you have an opportunity to serve. And that is often as needed as the first part. So we're excited to say we've got a program that's Pray One, Stay One. And with that, what we're looking to do is have people come and be in a service and then stay for the second service, or come at the service before they would normally come and fulfill some of the needs. A lot of the needs are needs that we have existing. Some of the needs are new programs that we feel that will enhance the church, and by doing that, we hope that the church will grow. So it's a number of things that we will be doing. Some of it is security and greeters. Some of it is helping with the coffee hour. Some of it is, there's just a number of things. In the weeks to come, you're going to see an insert in the bulletin. It looks like this. I'd ask you to look at that and pray over it. And we'll be down in Fellowship Hall for the next several weeks, after, not this week, but the next several weeks, and be able to answer any questions about if you would see something that you might be interested in. I'd ask that all of you pray over this and see if there's not something that you think you could fulfill, so that some of the people that are stretched almost beyond belief might get some relief, or might be able to attend one of the services that they're not able to do now. We're reminded of the baptismal vows that we confirm every time we celebrate the font, that we surround everyone with a community filled with examples of Christ, filled with love, prayers, and service. I thank you.
I invite you now to enter into our time of silence and centering as we prepare our hearts for worship. And then we will sing together number 173, Christ Whose Glory Fills Us.
Places and surprise us with the abundance of your love. I invite you to honor Christ and stand in body or spirit for the gospel reading. I will be reading John 21st chapter, verses 1 through 19. In your pew Bible, it's on page 109. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. They said to him, We will go without you. And they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, Children, you have no fish, have you? And they answered him, No. He said to them, Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some. And so they cast it. And now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, It is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and he jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there, with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, Bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, Come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, Who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, Yes, Lord. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my lambs. A second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, Follow me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I am Saul, and I have always been devout, and I don't do anything by half measures. As a Pharisee, I was completely focused on the law and being the strongest Pharisee I could be. And I saw Jesus and his disciples as a threat to our way of life. So many people, even Gentiles, were becoming followers of the way. I knew that Rome would only tolerate them for so long. If the Christians kept growing as they were, and I could see it from a mile away, that Rome wasn't going to allow Christians to keep the religious exemptions that the rest of the people of Israel enjoyed. So I went to the high priest with threats of murdering the disciples on my lips. and I asked him for letters to the synagogue in Damascus. My purpose was to find any Jews who were following the way so that I could bind them up and bring them to Jerusalem. As I was going along the road approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around me. I fell to the ground, and I heard a voice say to me, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" I asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were with me stood speechless, because they had heard the voices, but they saw no one. I got up from the ground, and though my eyes were open, I could see nothing. So they led me by the hand and brought me into Damascus. For 3 days I was without sight, and I neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias, and the Lord said to him, "Ananias." He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might again regain his sight." But Ananias said, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has the authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on me and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately, something like scales fell from my eyes, and my sight was restored. Then I got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, I regained my strength. For several days I was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately I began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." Amen.
It's a dramatic story. A villain struck down by a flash of light, Jesus' voice calling out. We tend to assume that Saul is the bad guy in this story, but is he really? It's important to remember that Saul sees himself as a good guy, trying to protect the faith. In this case, that means the Jews that have entered the movement around Jesus. You see, it wasn't until around the year 70 AD, after Jesus' death, that there became a separation between the way, as it's referred to in Acts, and the Jewish faith. At this point in the story, it is still possible to be both Jewish and Christian. And the way was essentially a new denomination of Judaism. And Paul is breathing threats and murder against the disciples because he is wanting to be a champion who's going after these Jews that have lost their way, that have found themselves in a place of what he perceives to be error. And he sees these Jews as being in need of rescue from these ways. And so he goes as a faithful Pharisee to the leaders of the synagogue in Damascus and ask for the authority to conduct his policing there, to clean up his faith community, and to rid it of the straying ones. As far as Saul is concerned, this is not a matter of going after people to persecute them, but rather a correction of those who have gone down. Saul is a classic example of a devout person who is determined to do good, and yet they are blinded, in this case even literally, to the destructive consequences of their purity campaign. He does much harm as he is trying to do good. And And so we have to be careful about how we see Saul. Rather than seeing him as a persecutor, we might see him as a committed servant, a son of the covenant, someone trying to do the right thing in order to strengthen the people of God. We might presume that Saul is shocked not only by the flash of light, but by the accusation of persecution. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? We read in verse 4. We might imagine Saul could hardly believe his ears, thinking, me? A persecutor? That is not Saul's understanding of himself. He has a focus on righteousness. It is one that has narrowed his vision to the point that he cannot see what God is up to. He is so convinced of the errors of others, they cannot see the new thing that God is doing in Jesus Christ and misreads the situation. Ultimately, later in the story, Paul is the one that God uses in writing the book of Romans to lay out the case in chapters 9, 10, and 11 that because God is always faithful to God's promises, those promises stand for all of the members of the covenant, Jews and followers of the way. Perhaps Saul's blindness can help us to see the ways that our own religious devotion, however righteous, can lead to obstructions. How do our religious commitments, or perhaps our political or ideological or social commitments, keep us from truly seeing a new thing that God is doing? How do we narrow rather than expand God's mission in the world? What in our good intentions do we misread? At both ends of the ideological spectrum, Christian progressive, Christian conservative, look to purge their ranks for any who step out of line. And the story that each side tells about themselves is that they are holding firm to sacred values. No one thinks of themselves as a persecutor. We would be shocked to hear Jesus say, "Why do you persecute me?" This week I was listening in an interview with Richard Rohr, who's a Franciscan priest who writes and teaches extensively, and he has a new book out. And he was asked about, the title of it is The Universal Christ, and he was asked, what relationships help you experience the universal Christ? And this was Rohr's reply. He said, I think it was when I first stretched myself into otherness. He went on to explain that he was living for the first time as a theologian in residence in Dayton, Ohio, and that part of his responsibility was to visit an inner city hospital in Dayton where most or all of the patients were poor. And he was trying to console and meet all of these people where they were, and it was a genuinely Christ-soaked experience because it was his first move really outside of the world that he had been living in. Living into the question of how do I relate to a poor black man, or how do I relate to a poor Latino woman? And then the recognition that he could not only do it, but that it was a wonderful Christ-soaked experience, powerful. That Christ is always in the experience when we cross the line of otherness. If we try, he says, to pull into sickness and try and stay with people who are just like ourselves, we don't experience Christ in his fullness because we are largely loving ourselves. That was the part that got me. When we stay with people who are just like us, we are largely loving only ourselves. There has to be an expanded circle because that's Jesus. guy. He is bad news. Like, are you not aware of this God? You know, just in case God needed reminding, right? And he's really, he's like, this person has been persecuting Christians everywhere he goes, and you want me to go to him? And so, of course, Ananias goes. And notice what his first response is when he walks in to see him. He lays hands on him and calls him brother. Makes me wonder what Paul must have looked like after 3 days of blindness and not eating. Probably not good. Enough to incite Ananias to move all the way from, are you kidding me, to a place of compassion. And this is what it is to follow Jesus. It's the kind of courage that Ananias has to go when he's called. It's the kind of compassion that Ananias demonstrates when he sees this man perceived to be his enemy. Christ is always experienced when we cross the line to others. On these days of Easter season, as we lead into Pentecost, as we prepare ourselves for the coming anew of the Holy Spirit to expand, not narrow, the vision of what God is up to far beyond ourselves, we might, along with our brother Paul, pause to examine our own blind spots, often tied to our deepest commitments. Amen. I invite you now to join with me in an attitude of prayer. O Lord, our God, we cry to you for help. We pray for those who are persecuted for their faith. Give them freedom, peace, safety. We pray for those who breathe curses and threats. Give them new hearts and new lives to glorify you. We pray for those who work by day and by night. Give them satisfaction and rest from their labors. We pray for those who fear their efforts are in vain. Fill their lives with your providence and your grace. We pray for all who suffer in sickness and grief. Give them healing, hope, and joy. We pray especially, O Lord, for Shirley and Katarina, as they prepare for surgery in this month of May. We pray for the faithful in every nation of the earth. Give them voices to praise your name forever. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, who loves us, feeds us, who saves us. Amen. I invite our ushers to come forward as we prepare to worship God with our tithes and our offerings. In addition to giving through this offering time, you may also give using our smartphone app to give electronically. That smartphone app also has our church calendar and recordings of services and other information about our community of faith.
Let us pray. Jesus calls us to feed his lambs and tend his sheep. Let us show and share his love through the offering of our lives. Amen.
Thank you.
8, and the faith be safe, turn to page 2257B. And once we sing the first response, we will then be seated. I also want to call our attention to the fact that this is the first Sunday that we are also consecrating the elements for our home communion ministry. And so we will be praying for those who are going to be receiving the sacrament at home because they are unable to be with us in worship. And we are grateful for those servants who are planning to go out. And if you would like to become one of those servants, I invite you to do so. We would love to have you participate. And now let us begin on page number 8 with our prayer of confession. Merciful God,
we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful needs. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, praise your name and join their unending hymn. Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. as you have heard the word of love proclaimed, go forth and share. As you have been fed at this table, go forth and feed. And may the grace of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you this day and always.